Good evening. My name is Leela Bett O'Connor. Hello and welcome to the 2021 Repro Film Fest. I am one of the co-founders of Repro, the only film festival in the world dedicated to women's reproductive justice and rights. When you purchase a ticket and donate to Repro, or even participate and watch one of these conversations, you have become an active participant of change. And all of our net ticket sales support our three beneficiary organizations, Black Women's Health Imperative, the Lilith Fund, and No More Secrets. You can get all of the info at reprofilmfest.com. We'd like to thank our sponsors, including Bloomberg Philanthropies, the Stober Lafer Foundation, and the Laurie M. Tisch Illumination Fund, and the Shepherd Foundation. I'm extremely happy tonight to be joined by our Repro co-founders, Mallory Martin and Debbie Samples. And at the end of this call to action conversation, we'll take an exclusive sneak peek at the upcoming documentary, Red Alert, The Fight Against Fibroids. But first, we're honored to introduce the director and producer behind the film, Erica L. Taylor.
Hi, everyone.
Thanks so much for being with us today, Erica.
Thank you for having me. This is amazing.
We're so honored to have you. We're so honored to have you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I'm Mallory Martin with Repro, and I'm going to sort of jump right in with questions for you, Erica. But I want to back up a minute and just kind of tell our side of the story of how we met you virtually first and how we got connected to you. And we were looking for films for this year's festival. And if you were with us for Repro in the first year, we had a film about endometriosis, which was really important and something we weren't even aware of at first, and something that we weren't sure was going to be part of this festival. But we felt that this topic was so crucial to the festival as a whole last year. And we kept hearing things from different audience members about how that was the film that they connected with the most and they learned a lot from it. And it was really important. So once I heard about Erica's film, I started badgering her about playing it for this year's festival, but she's still in the middle of it, hopefully getting close to the end, which I'll have you talk about soon. And so wasn't ready for this year's festival, but she agreed to do a little sneak peek and still have a conversation with us because we absolutely did not want our audience to miss out on learning about this. And this is kind of the most captive our audience is this time of year. So we're thrilled that you're all here with us to learn about this today and to learn more about Erica's film. So Erica, I definitely would love for you to kind of recap our first conversation with you in some ways, that you shared how very personal of a film this is that you're making. And it's not easy to talk about your reproductive health or reproductive health in general, but especially when it's about your own. We'd love for you to start with your story and your experiences with fibroids and how that ended up leading to you making this film.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Mallory. And it's such an honor to speak with all of you. I think what you're doing is absolutely amazing and a gift to all women. But to answer your question, the journey to make this film for me started back in 2008 when I was first diagnosed with fibroids. I had such a lack of information and I was scared and I had no idea what was happening. And all I heard was the word tumor and my uterus. I just knew that those two things were involved and that was enough for me to go into panic mode. But at the same time, I think that's when the first advocacy gene for me kicked in because I didn't take what my doctor told me verbatim. I was trying to be fit for an IUD and I was hoping that would help control heavy bleeding every month. And when I tried to get fitted for the IUD, I screamed because I was in so much pain. And the doctor at the time told me, oh, it's just some women can't wear these. And I couldn't accept that. So I sought a second opinion. And at that second opinion is where I was given a transvaginal ultrasound and I was told that I have fibroid tumors. Had never heard of fibroids, didn't know they existed. I just knew that every month I found myself in the fetal position and unable to do just simple things every month, you know, just even walking on that particular heavy day was just unheard of. I couldn't do it. So going through multiple procedures after that, I had my cervix frozen. I had a laparoscopic surgery where I thought that she was going to go in there and take out some fibroids, but she actually ended up taking out my appendix and leaving the fibroids. That was surgery number two, I think. And then from there, I had a surgery where I had 22 cuts in my uterus and 22 fibroids removed with cysts and ovaries, and ended up in an intensive care unit. And then, you know, some years after that, actually just last year, I had my last myomectomy. I should say my next myomectomy, because my fibroids did return and I had another 18 tumors removed. So in all this time, there's so much happening in my life. You know, the journey started when I was in my early 30s. But in actuality, I've been dealing with like really heavy periods and a lot of pain since I was a teenager, maybe even a little younger than that. So there was a lot going on in my life that kept telling me, there's something more to this. There's something more than what the doctors are telling me. And there's more than just my pain, because I felt like my pain just surrounded my life for so long. So, you know, leading up through, I would say 2015, when I did my first film, I produced my first film with a friend of mine, Jasmine Leyva, called The Invisible Vegan. And it was a documentary on veganism and the Black community. And at that time, I started doing some Google searching, some deep searching about fibroid tumors and how your diet can be affected. The symptoms can affect, your diet can affect the symptoms of fibroid tumors. So through that journey is when I first started talking about fibroids on camera. And I was a little apprehensive at first, because that's not a conversation that's typically open to the public. We just, as you all know, we don't really talk about reproductive health as much as we should. So in working in that film, you know, I opened up about my surgery, opened up about the problems that I've had, which I will unveil more of that in the film. But I'm happy just to say, you know, to let this audience know, you know, having that fibroid surgery where things went so wrong in 2015 for me, 2014 for me, was it was unspeakable. Because I could not drive, I couldn't go to work. I worked in entertainment, and that's not a guaranteed job when you're in Hollywood. If you can't go to work, you're pretty much going to be replaced pretty quickly. So I was unable to return to work. I ended up on food stamps, and it was just a really bad situation. Disability ran out because I could not make that hour and a half long drive to work every day. I couldn't sit for long periods of time. I couldn't stand for long periods of time. And this was after spending, you know, like 5 to 7 days in intensive care. So that was when I started talking about that in The Invisible Vegan, and the film came out, women started reaching out to me on social media, and they kept, you know, saying, "Oh, I'm so glad that you opened up about your story. And thank you so much for making me feel like I wasn't so alone." And I started getting more and more of that. And I'm like, okay, well, there's something there. This is good. I still wasn't convinced that this was the next film for me. It wasn't until I had a miscarriage in 2019. I had been given a 0.1% chance of getting pregnant. And I went completely 100% vegan in January of 2019, and I was pregnant in March. And so the reason I found out I was pregnant was because I was having a miscarriage. At the time, I was excited about the fact that I had even gotten pregnant, but, you know, yet and still, it was a miscarriage. That was the next sign that said, something has to be done. This is happening because of fibroids. So later on that year, you know, my husband and I, you know, kept trying, and lo and behold, again in September, I got pregnant again. But this time my fibroids had gotten larger. So that time the pregnancy lasted about 6 weeks. So we were really happy that it lasted that long, but it was very sad time, very disheartening. And so after that, I just said, this is inevitable. I have to do this film. Women were still reaching out to me. I was opening more about my experience on social media, and people said, you know, thank you, thank you, thank you. I said, okay, Erica, you have enough signs. Get this film done. Women need to have a voice. We need to have some type of a relief in this area. And that's not even touching on the fact that, you know, I had been told that I can only have a hysterectomy and there was nothing else that could be done when I was in my early 30s. You know, I was told this by a doctor. And so all these little components over the years, over like a, I would say maybe an 8-year period is what contributed towards my my drive to get the film done. And then the more that I researched about uterine fibroids online, the less I saw. I saw that, you know, there's this little thing that comes up in Google that says that uterine fibroids are benign tumors that some women suffer from. Most women don't have any symptoms, and that's pretty much all you're going to find. But I know for a fact that there are 171 million women worldwide with fibroid tumors. 80% of African-American women will have and suffer from fibroid tumors by age 50. That's a pretty huge number, and that number keeps growing. So for me to Google this reproductive pandemic and not be able to get the information that I needed, for me to go through everything that I've gone through with my body, for me to watch some of my friends go through what they've gone through, infertility, miscarriage, depression, anemia, all of that. And there's no information out there for me. And when we go to the doctors, their only solution is a hysterectomy most of the time. That's unacceptable. It's totally unacceptable. Then later on in research, I'm finding out, you know, that there's, I'll save that comment for later, but I could go on and on, as you know, Mallory.
No. I mean, we could listen to you over and over again to talk about this. Thank you so much for sharing the personal parts of that story, especially. And I think we are all already grateful that you did decide to make the film. And I hope that when it is finished, everybody, as many women especially as possible, can see it, because I think you're going to change lives for a lot of women.
And I think just revisiting what you just said, it speaks volumes, not only about what our media covers, but our healthcare system overall. It's not geared to help women. And we'll get to this later, because again, from our first conversation with you, we learned so much about so many things, but also being an advocate. But we'll circle back to that in a second. But Erica, I do want to step things back a little here and just take it more to the technical side, and wondering if you could walk everyone through, for those that need a little 101 course, what exactly fibroids and endometriosis are.
Absolutely. Uterine fibroid tumors are benign tumor growths that grow in several places of the uterus, or I should say they can grow in several places. They can be within the uterine wall, they can be inside the uterus, they can be on the outside of the uterus. And depending on the location of where the fibroid is, the tumor is in your uterus, depends on, that's gonna depend on how heavy your symptoms are. Let me first also say that I am not a physician. This is information that is freely available online, because of my vast experience with fibroids, I have done some research, so I can't answer the question as to, what they are and how they could affect your body and things like that. So they are non-cancerous. I will say that they are non-cancerous. However, in the most recent years, there have been studies about fibroids being linked to other reproductive health issues. Surgeons are going in and finding that a woman who has uterine fibroids might also be accompanied with endometriosis or with polyps. I don't know that there's a connection to cysts, but I'll put it like this. The conversations I've had with women like that have had uterine fibroids like myself, we have a lot in common, and a lot of those things are endometriosis and cysts. So there might be a link to it. That has yet to be a study to be done, but they are these non-cancerous tumors that can grow in multiples. Sometimes they might be, you might have one fibroid. They can grow very large. There are women who have had fibroids that are the size of cantaloupes. Sometimes women might look pregnant and they're not pregnant, and it could be because of a fibroid. I've got friends who consistently are asked by other people around them, oh, when's your baby due? They're not pregnant. It's a fibroid tumor that's protruding out from their stomach. And sometimes you can touch your stomach and feel a fibroid, or touch a little bit low in your pelvic region and feel something hard, and that could be a fibroid tumor. So for anyone that's watching, definitely, do some self-checks, just like you do your monthly breast exam. You know, you want to feel around that pelvic region for any type of hard lumps or something like that. And even if you don't feel any and you have other fibroid symptoms, you could still have fibroids. Hmm.
And sorry, just a couple of things like I wanted to touch on real quick before going to the next question from what you said is that it's so infuriating too, because you say things like they don't know yet if cis or connector or whatever. And a lot of that is because there hasn't been the research, the adequate research done yet. So it doesn't mean that that's not connected. It's just that that research has not been done. There hasn't been enough funding to do that research. And that's a huge part of the problem.
Absolutely.
And this is painful, right? I mean, this can be very painful for women, not just physically, but also mentally having to go through that. So can I ask a weird question though, too, is you mentioned, I think your second surgery, they removed your appendix. Was that?
That was actually the first. The cryo surgery where my cervix was frozen. That was the first surgery. That was actually in the office. So that was, considered something, a procedure where they freeze your cervix and try to control the bleeding of your period. The second surgery I had was actually in the OR. It was laparoscopic surgery. And the doctor went in and she saw that I had 6 or 7 fibroid tumors. And she said that she saw some within my uterine wall. So she didn't want to remove them because she was afraid that I wouldn't be able to carry a child later. So she didn't want to remove any of the fibroids, even though not all of them were in my uterine wall. So while she was digging around in there, she just said that she saw that my appendix had been kind of padded down by scar tissue. Mm. And so she decided to go in and remove my appendix, which was a shock to me because I didn't know that, you know, OBGYNs were in the habit of removing appendices. But it was definitely a very daunting experience, to say the least. I had, remember telling my employer that I was only going to be out for like a day or two, because with laparoscopy, they just go in and just take a look. And I was actually out for about a week dealing with that. And, at the same time, something that I'll be talking about in the film, the conditions at home were not acceptable for me to be just unable to take care of myself. I'll just say that.
Right. Yeah. And so, Erica, you had mentioned your miscarriages too, which is just an even more extreme, awful part of what can happen from fibroids and endometriosis. So we know that that fertility can be affected by fibroids, and especially if that's something that's misdiagnosed, can just be compounded on how terrible of an experience that can be for so many women. Are there other things that it can affect besides, or can you talk a little bit more about fertility too, and how common that is for women to experience miscarriages as well?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, this is something that I wish I could present a statistic on, but unfortunately, Mallory, there's no statistic because a lot of women do not tell people when this has happened. I personally know several people just in my own, circle that have gone through this, but it's very common. Fibroids, especially if you have them treated with an invasive surgery, that weakens the uterine wall. If you've had fibroids removed through surgery, any type of surgery on your uterus, it's going to weaken it over time. And for women with fibroids, a lot of time we have multiples. We have that gene that's going to multiply the fibroids. So that surgery becomes even more invasive because those fibroids, will be removed through that invasive surgery. And so it can cause infertility, which is what I'm currently dealing with now. Mm-hmm. We've gone through several treatments for infertility. We've been trying for about 5 years. And we've had those 2 miscarriages along the way. And then I've had that next surgery since then to remove other fibroids because they do come back. Mm-hmm. But as far as infertility, there are other treatment options out there that are less invasive than a myomectomy, a surgery where you are cut across your midsection. You have like a larger than a C-section scar across your pelvis. And that surgery can be abdominal or it can be robotic. But there are other treatment options out there that are less invasive that still leave a woman with some fertility options in the end. And I just wanted to mention that because one of the biggest arguments that we have about fibroid awareness is that the options aren't being told to the patients. the option that the physician might specialize in at the time is what's being told to the patient. But we're really urging for women to go and educate themselves so that they can know what options they can talk to their physician about. Because maybe if they had the less invasive option, your fertility might not be as compromised. So that, you know, so we want to make sure that women know all of that information. But yes, there are, you can have issues from either the treatment of fibroids, or you could have issues from the fibroid themselves. Mm-hmm. Fibroids have a tendency to steal the blood supply. They feed off estrogen, they feed off the blood supply, and those things are needed to make a baby, you know? Mm-hmm. So progesterone is needed to make a baby. So so the things that the fibroids are feeding on are either going to, they're going to hurt your chances of conceiving and potentially carrying to term, because when women get pregnant, a lot of times those fibroids are gonna grow because of the hormonal balance that needs to happen. So especially with you needing progesterone, which is one of the things that I recently had to face, because when we were trying our recent IUI, I had to take progesterone pills. And progesterone and estrogen are what the fibroid is feeding on. So for a woman with a history of fibroids, it's kind of, it's a catch-22 situation when you have to take progesterone pills to try to get pregnant, because now you're running the risk of maybe like bringing your fibroids back sooner, you know? So it's a really touchy situation. So it's always good to work with a professional. One of the things that I sought after when I had my first fibroid surgery and my second was that the OBGYN that I worked with, they had to be into saving the uterus and have extensive experience with women with fibroid tumors. So that's a really important thing that I think women should really think about when they're looking for a surgeon or they're looking for an OBGYN.
That's great advice. Thank you.
Can I ask a question, Erica? You mentioned a little bit about the pain, but what are some of the other symptoms of having fibroids that like you might not even know?
Absolutely. So with fibroids, because, you know, you're, like I said, the blood supply, they feed off blood, women might experience anemia. Anemia means that your hemoglobin levels are low. And so you might experience some fatigue. You might look a little pale. You know, I know for me, I got a little darkness under my eyes. One of the other strange symptoms is pica. Women who are really anemic have a tendency sometimes to experience pica. Pica is when you start craving really unusual things. So ice was a really big one for me. Before I had my last surgery, I could just chew ice all day long. My body craved ice. Some women, it might be dirt. You know, you just some things that, you know, you just don't know what you're going to crave. But if you have a craving for something like ice or something strange like dirt or something like that, then you definitely want to get your levels checked. And it definitely could mean that you have fibroids. Cramping, just spontaneous cramping. A lot of times I would just be sitting still somewhere, sitting at my desk working, and I'll just jump, because I'll get like this pain all of a sudden, and then a throbbing down below. I can't tell you how many times when I was younger in my 30s that I thought I might be pregnant because I felt a flutter, or I felt like a little jolt down in my pelvic region. And I was always taking a pregnancy test, even though it might not even be humanly possible at the time, because I thought something was going on down there. It was fibroids. So, you know, between the cramping, definitely during the period, if you are soaking through an unusual amount of pads in an hour, you know, you might be using one of the larger maxi pads on the market and you're soaking through it in an hour or 2 hours, you definitely want to go get a sonogram, a transvaginal sonogram, to see if you have fibroids. So it's the heavy periods, it's the cramping, extreme cramping, it's the fatigue from the anemia, you know, it could be a number of those things that you want to talk to your doctor about, definitely.
That is such great, like, knowledge to have, because I feel like so often we just chalk it up to like, oh, it's hormones, or oh, I'm stressed, mm-hmm. or oh, I'm going through, you know, perimenopause or whatever yeah. it is. So we don't think that like there could be something further to it. And it's so important to think about that. And can we just talk a little bit about like who it is that's being most affected by fibroids, and then touching on the inequities in the healthcare around that? Because I know that your film is going to delve into that as well.
Absolutely. And I want to kind of touch on the inequities of the healthcare a little bit first, kind of in concert with what Mallory was discussing earlier. But I was shocked to find that the National Institute of Health has only been allocated they only allocate $17 million for fibroid research. $17 million. When you think of those numbers in terms of erectile dysfunction mm-hmm. funding and research, and contraception funding and research, which is off the charts, $17 million is nothing. There is also there is a lack of physicians willing to do the research needed to get these answers that we need about fibroids as well. So they're definitely looking for more physicians to go into that research arena for fibroid, uterine fibroids, so that we can get more answers. So I wanted to just basically mention that first.
That's a great point. Sorry to interrupt you, but like $17 million is like a low, low budget film.
Absolutely.
Just putting it that way.
Absolutely. You know, it's when I heard that number, I felt hurt, to be honest with you. At the time that I heard that number, we were in the middle of the Black Lives Matter movement. And I already had this feeling that as a Black woman, I feel like that the priority list for my health and my well-being is so low in this country. And then they tell me that an illness, an epidemic that affects so many African-American women only gets $17 million of funding. It broke my heart. And it made me want to fight even harder. So, you know, in to answer your question as well, yes, Black women are affected the most by this. 70% of all women have fibroids. Let's just put that out there first. 70% of all women have fibroid tumors. That is a statistic from the National Institute of Health and other studies that have been done. But Black women will suffer from the symptoms of fibroid tumors. Just like Black women are more likely to die from breast cancer, even though there are large numbers of women of all races that have breast cancer. Black women are more likely to die from breast cancer. Black women are more likely to have the worst symptoms from fibroid tumors. So knowing those numbers and knowing those facts, you have to ask yourself, why isn't there more put into research? If we've been suffering from this since the beginning of time, I think I read somewhere that they found fibroids maybe in some canopic jars in the Egyptian pyramids. If we've been suffering that long, why is it that we're only allocating such a small amount of resources toward fibroid tumors? So, you know, you pull all that together, and for me, and also knowing that women in underserved markets, underserved communities, mostly minority women, don't get the healthcare that they need. A lot of them are suffering in silence every month, dealing with heavy periods and bleeding and having to push through their activities every single day, push through being a mom of multiple children, push through being a wife, push through being a teacher, pushing through all these phenomenal, wonderful things that we're doing out in the world, but we're secretly suffering in silence from these tumors. So, you know, to answer your question, that's, you know, the biggest driving force for me is to know that so many women as a whole are suffering, but also knowing that so many women that look like me are suffering and pushing through pain, you know, in concert with everything else that we're dealing with in this world, in this country. And one of the other things I wanted to say is African women have even worse statistics when it comes to fibroids. Most recently, I've read that I think it's 3 in 5 African women have fibroid tumors, and they are some of the toughest and worst cases around.
I think the number is staggering. That 17 million is ringing in my ears right now, because, and you described it as heartbreaking, which is absolutely true, but it is so dismissive of an entire population. It's infuriating to hear that. And I don't want to lose track of something, Erica, that we talked about, and I said this before we went live, that when we spoke with you the first time, we learned so much from you and just how you were living in the world. So I want to make sure that we circle back and talk about being our own best advocates. And just like that number is dismissive, I think women as a whole are completely dismissed in healthcare in terms of, oh, like Leela said, it's hormones, it's, you know, this, that, or the other. How were you able, through your research, to become such an advocate? And can you talk about just how important it is and vital for us to move forward that we are being our best advocates for ourselves?
Absolutely. For this film, for me, I've chosen to become a voice for the voiceless. There's so many women who are still afraid to speak out. And once I started down this path, the path just kind of like started to smooth out for me. As far as determining where I was in this journey, where I was in this advocacy, while I was working on the film, and I love telling the story, I was minding my own business making a documentary. And a group of people reached out to me from the USA Fibroid Centers. And they were looking at, not only did they become a marquee sponsor of the film, but they were looking to start an ambassador program. And they wanted to start that following year and asked me to be their first ambassador. And I did oblige them and was contracted to become an ambassador. And through that, I've been able to speak to roomfuls of people carefully about fibroid awareness and connect with the fibroid awareness community through social media and the other organizations that are involved with fibroid awareness, like the White Dress Project, the Fibroid Foundation, and definitely Fibroid Fighters, which is the nonprofit of USA Fibroid Centers. So through that, I've been able to kind of amplify my voice about fibroid awareness, which is so important to me. And in doing so, when I'm giving a speech and women come up to me afterwards and they talk about their fibroid story and they feel comfortable talking to me about it, oh my gosh, that's the best feeling in the world. It helps me to, it fuels me. It helps me to remember why I'm doing this. It helps me to remember that even when I'm getting a little hoarse, to keep talking. There's someone listening. There's someone listening to you that needs to hear your story. There's someone that needs answers. There's someone who might have just experienced a breakup because, you know, they couldn't be intimate because they had fibroids. There's someone who just went through a miscarriage. You know, there's a 40-plus-year-old woman who's about to have a myomectomy and has no children and still wants to and wants to know how I did it, how I'm still surviving, how I'm still pushing forward in my own fertility journey. There's always someone that's going to be there that wants to hear your voice about the issue that you're dealing with. And that's what I learned while I've become an advocate. One of the biggest driving forces that I had was not just my own journey, but I wanted to start my own foundation to help women pay for their healthcare needs. Speaking more on my personal journey, when we experienced our miscarriages, we did not have health insurance. We were out of the open enrollment period. This was before the open enrollment period changed, and we didn't have health insurance. So we had two unexpected pregnancies and miscarriages without health insurance. We had about, and still have about $35,000 worth of medical bills that are unpaid from miscarriages. That is a story for so many women. I'm not alone. When you think about women in underserved communities who are barely getting by and they experience something like this, it almost brings tears to my eyes to think about them having to go through this. And they might even have children already that are looking to them for food and for sustainability. And they're even dealing with this. So all those reasons are the reasons why I became an advocate, why I want to continue advocacy. We need that repro justice, hashtag repro justice in our lives, because if we don't do it, no one will do it for us. We have to do it for ourselves. So my goal is to not only talk about it from my own experience, but to also empower other women to talk about their experience themselves, but most importantly, empower women to ask those questions of their doctors when they're in the doctor's office. Make your notes, make your list, know what you need to talk to your doctor about, what questions to ask. If someone wants to do an ultrasound on top of your stomach, make them do a transvaginal ultrasound so that you can be more educated about what's going on with your body and maybe not just take one answer as verbatim, especially if that answer hits you dead in your heart because the doctor's told you that you need a hysterectomy. Look for your options. So all those reasons, Debbie, are why I truly am going to continue being an advocate for this cause.
Erica, I just want to say that I am crying. It's conversations like these that like move, I think, the work that this is why we do the work that we do. But I also want to say that, like, something you just said about repro justice, that hashtag, I feel like, and we talked about this and we've talked about it before, is like, when people think about reproductive rights and reproductive justice, they automatically think about one issue, which is abortion, yeah. And it gets politicized. And yeah. They don't think about all the other things that people with a uterus have yeah. to deal with, from yes. fibroids to miscarriages to endometriosis to all these things. And it's just such a great reminder to think that justice means so much more than just, absolutely. You know, one politicized, you know, blue and red issue. So thank
absolutely.
You. Thank
absolutely.
You so much for speaking to so honestly about this. I mean, it really, it's so moving.
Oh, thank you so much. And by the way, I'm a crier too, so I'll have to try to hold back on that. But no, it's definitely something that that I'm so very passionate about. You know, the conversation really has been amplified about maternal mortality in African American women lately, and a common thing that's been said is that the doctors aren't listening to the mothers. I've seen some videos that have been posted out on social media of physicians, whether, I don't know if they were knew they were being taped or not, saying that sometimes they don't believe the Black women when they talk about their pain. It's like, why? Well, number one, thank you for saying that out loud so we know, but it touches your soul when someone says that to you, but it hurts your heart to know that that's actually someone's truth. That's the truth of a lot of women. You know, we have women in the public eye now, like Serena and Allison Felix, who talk about, you know, them not having voices or being heard in the delivery room or being heard about issues they've had after delivering. And so that becomes, you know, it becomes something when they speak about it. It becomes something when someone says that's not right, because it's not. It's not the way that it should be, but it is the way that it has been. And that is not the way that we want to go into the future. It's just not.
And by you speaking up and just speaking your truth and being so open with your story, it really creates a safe space for someone who might not be, you know, prompted to or brave enough or whatever it is on their own to do that. But seeing that example and being that person that maybe I didn't have that showed me there is a way to be your own advocate really sets that whole thing in motion. And right now, I'm looking at the comments and it's just, thanks for sharing your story, Erica, extremely impactful story. This is exactly why you need to keep speaking. People are so affected when you hear that you're not alone. So I'm actually going to start getting in some audience questions here because we do have some. Let me see here. So from our first audience member, Erica, it reads, I've never heard about fibroids until now, but it seems to affect so many women. Why is this not talked about more by our sex ed teachers or by our OBGYNs? And I love that they mentioned sex ed because sex ed needs a complete revamp.
Absolutely. This is actually something that we talk about in the film as well, and that I also talk about as a brand ambassador for Fibroid Fighters. We are actively talking with legislators about hopefully putting some type of system in place with health education to talk about not just what's happening to your body, but what also could go wrong. especially if we know that, you know, there is a certain pool of women that are really suffering from this as they get older. You know, this is a conversation that we can potentially start having with school age kids, like middle school, high school, college. We should be talking about the things that could potentially go wrong, or the things that you might feel if there's something that you need to investigate or you need to talk to your doctor about. So, you know, it's definitely a hot topic to get that conversation started with, you know, school age girls, because it's so important. You know, when I think back to when I had my first period, I was 11 years old. And at 11, what do you know about? You know about hopscotch, you know about, you know, jumping rope, things like that. You don't anticipate, you know, extremely heavy periods and being in pain and not being able to express that to your friends on the playground and things like that. So this is a conversation that, you know, we need to start. We need to start talking about, you know, the things that could go wrong, things to look for, I should say, with younger generations. At least give it a couple of mentions in a textbook or a brochure. Give us that. You know, at least. So, you know, definitely is something that I agree that we should be talking about at an earlier age, most certainly.
Yeah, the time to speak about those things is not when you're in crisis. I mean, that's exactly. not the best moment. I also want to bring up one more comment that someone just said. It said, Leela, this will make you feel happy. I was in tears too, Leela. It's so real for so many of us. So again, thank you, Erica, for for speaking so clearly. Open and honestly.
And you're right. The time to have those conversations and normalize them is at a young age. I have a 12-year-old who just got her period. And so talking about those, and my 6-year-old is like, oh, did Edie just get her period? Sorry, Edie. I'm just outing you on YouTube. But like, honestly, like having those conversations and normalizing it all is, I think, so important at this age, like with younger people too. And sorry, they're talking really loud in the background.
All right, I'm going to move us on to the next question. If you suspect you might have fibroids or endometriosis, or if you have been diagnosed, what are steps you can take on your own, for example, diet preventative measures?
Sure. So we do know that there are some foods that could affect the symptoms of fibroids. I'm not 100% sure about endometriosis, even though I do have endometriosis. It has been removed from both of my ovaries, but I did become vegan because of those symptoms. Red meat, the hormones in red meat have been said to potentially have an effect on the symptoms of fibroids, making the symptoms worse. So you definitely want to watch your red meat intake, your alcohol intake, your caffeine intake. You want to monitor those things because all those things can aggravate fibroid tumors. I am missing coffee. I'm not going to lie. I gave up coffee like a couple years ago, and I'm a good wife. I still make coffee for my husband every day, but yeah, I miss coffee a lot. definitely want to watch that. But one of the biggest proponents for women with fibroids that you want to stay away from is soy. Soy makes estrogen. And, you know, even though we love our sushi, we love things like that, love our soy sauce, you really got to watch soy. It's at the top of the list, if not number one on the list, for foods that build estrogen, thereby making your fibroids more aggravated. So you may want to watch that as well. So overall, just kind of watch that, watch your diet. There are some foods that are estrogen producing foods. I would suggest doing a search online to find out what those foods are. I did it myself. And so I shy away from certain things. So you definitely want to do your research on that. You definitely want to get some exercise in. I know that's easier said than done. I don't like to exercise, I'm not gonna lie. I'm not a huge exercise fan, but I did recently start a dance class, a hip-hop dance class. So you know, just get moving a little bit more to not give your body a chance to really settle into that pain. But I will say, don't get caught up on weight. That is my personal opinion. You will find studies out there or people saying that if you keep your weight down, you could lessen the effects of the fibroids. And that may be true as well. But when I was, I want to say it was around 2011, I decided I wanted to lose weight, so I took some of these fancy diet pills on the market. I stopped eating all carbs. I ate all protein. I lost 46 pounds. I was down to a size 2, and I still had 22 tumors. I'm sorry, I had about 10 tumors growing to 22 at the time. So my weight didn't have anything to do with the fact that my thyroids were multiplying. That's more of like a gene mutation type thing that's going on. So for women who might be on the heavier side or the curvier side, you know, don't fall into depression because you're a little bit bigger and you have fibroids or endometriosis. Just do what you can. Do what you can to try to stay healthy. Watch those foods that produce estrogen, and definitely talk to your doctor about treatment options. And I want to mention also that one of the options that we talk about, that I talk about as a brand ambassador, is uterine fibroid embolization, which is something that I was unaware of when I was diagnosed. And even though that treatment has been in the United States since, I would say, the 90s, a lot of doctors do not really push UFE, and they might even tell you that you can't get pregnant after UFE. But after working with some interventional radiologists who are the people that do UFE, you can still get pregnant. So do your research on that as well, because you might also have that treatment option available where you won't have to be cut across your pelvic region to have some fibroid relief.
Okay, I'm going to take this next question from the audience because it's a question of my own, Erica, and you might not have the answer to this yet, but we all want to know, when can we see your film?
Man, I want to see that film too, girl. No. So originally we were supposed to release this past July. Because of COVID, we had to put our production on hold for almost a year. So we are scrambling, trying to get back to where we originally were. We are actually at the end, we're nearing the end of production, which means that we are nearing the end of filming. But we are currently in a fundraising stage. So we are looking to do some fundraising to get to our film finishing fund. And I want to see this thing done by December 31st. I want to see it, you know, just completely done, master cut, ready to go, ready for film festivals, and ready to present for next year's film, Repro Film Fest. Yeah. So definitely by the end of the year is what I'm hoping for the film to be completed, but that will also depend on how much funding we can raise. Mm-hmm. We are still looking to raise about $80,000 to finish the film. Okay. And we have some people out there, you know, running around a hamster wheel right now, but you know, the ability is to give to the film. If you're an individual with special thanks film credit, is on our Instagram page. There's a link there to do that. You can also give through our website, redalertmovie.com. You can email me, and I'm going to go ahead and put my email address out there, which is erica@redalertmovie.com. If you're interested in giving, listen, no amount is a bad amount. There's no bad amounts here. If you're like, hey, I can only give $5. Listen, you've given $5 towards an amazing cause, and you'll still see your name right there on the credits. So, you know, that's what we're looking at right now.
And there, I added your email on the bottom.
Well, thank you. And I'm sorry, it's erica@redalertmovie.com.
Movie.com. We'll add it into the description so everybody can link to your film too.
Thank you so much. And yeah, thank you for that, Mallory.
So the last question we have for you, Erica, is something we like to end with, that we started with our call to action conversations last year. What gives you hope, and what is your call to action for the Repro audience?
Oh, wow. What gives me hope? There's so many things that give me hope. You know, I'm going to be honest. I don't want to draw tears, but when I see babies and children, they give me hope. I was in the park the other day. Sometimes I'll just go and sit at the lake and just kind of think or listen to some inspirational podcast or something like that. And I saw a group of women with a child that could be no older than about 8 months, and she was trying to balance on her little legs. And I just looked at her and I just thought to myself, you have a whole future ahead of you, and there's nothing you can't do. There's so much potential within you. And I literally said those words out loud to this little girl that will never hear them from my mouth and that will never see me. But when I see kids and I see babies, I see hope. I see beings that are the closest to God for me, and I see our future. So definitely, you know, children and babies give me hope. When I see women speaking out and fighting for what they believe in, I see hope. I have hope. When I see people fighting for justice, those kind of things give me hope. When I see people being authentic, being their best self, being who God made them, that's what gives me hope. You know, even when things are really going bad or they're really tough, praying gives me hope. I would say prayer is number one on the list. That's where I find my hope, that's where I find my sustainability, and that's why I find true, real love and authenticity. That's where I find it. I find it in prayer. And I'm sorry, what was the second part?
What is your call to action for the Repro audience?
Absolutely. So Repro audience, I want you, if you are a woman or if you have a woman in your home, make sure that she definitely gets her well women's exam every year. Make sure that she is healthy. Look in her eyes. Look in her eyes to see how she's really doing. This goes for women all over everywhere. This goes for your friends, your family, your mom, your sister. Look in her eyes and see how she's really doing every once in a while to make sure she's okay. Another call to action would be definitely follow us on all of our social media. Keep up with Red Alert. I want to keep up with you, so I want to hear from you. Our followers have the ability to DM us on social media. So if you have a fibroid story, talk to me about it. Support causes like Repro Film Fest. Support causes where for women and girls. We need advocates. We definitely need male advocates. We can advocate for ourselves, but we need men to speak out for us as well. Those are my call to actions for the audience and for anyone watching and just anyone in general.
Well, Erica, I got to tell you that we spend a lot of time talking about what gives us hope, because I think a lot of times with Repro, they're just heavy subjects, right? Because that's what it's all about. It's about bringing awareness. And I'm going to say this, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. It's leaders like you and voices like yours that give us hope. And now I'm going to start crying. I really cannot thank you enough for being so open and honest and authentic. You are great at what you do, but you are even better at who you are. And we want to thank our audience for participating in this call to action conversation. It's so important. Please consider helping Erica's cause and keeping up to date on the film by subscribing at redalert.com.
Red Alert Movie.
redalertmovie.com. Thank you. Thank you for joining us during the Repro Film Fest and playing an active role in the movement for change.